So every time you say action, it just makes me laugh. This body of work came out of the miscarriage show in London in 2015. One of the pieces was called Precious in Thy Sight, which was based on the Last Supper in an everyday context. On the table itself was a group of soldiers which didn't really go together, and they represented a kind of daily friction, what exists within a family unit. It's the table round the mealtime, it's happy, sad, people crying, people shouting, people having strops. It's all part of the daily makeup of a family life. And there was something interesting in that for me. The toy soldiers, I felt, just had more in them. I hadn't exhausted them at that point. The toy soldiers seemed to capture my excitement as a child of The World at War, that wonderful documentary, the Action Man, and also my love of battle comics, which I used to get weekly. I felt that there was just, I don't know, I call it an artistic hunch, call it a gut feeling, I'm not sure, but I think there's something in that, there was more. And that's what I set up with. This is an emotional landscape. These paintings are based on an emotional landscape. It's about different emotions which exist in all our lives, which exist in all our lives. And none of it goes together, but they all go together. Sadness meets happiness meets jealousy meets frustration meets boredom. You know, one minute my dad can be having a stroke, the next minute I'm doing the shopping, or I'm having a beer with a friend, or my kids have got problems, or we're telling a really crap joke over lunchtime. And all these things, these emotional issues, all sit together, yet none of them go together. And what I became really fascinated by is how these collide and become this kaleidoscopic emotional landscape. And we have different strategies which we use to cope, and the formations and the battles and the soldiers being from different regiments and different times. It's all about this friction, which relates to an emotional, frictional landscape. When I completed this picture, you know, I was beginning to understand what I've done. There was a big thing happened, which when I took this picture off, I realised that it actually left a trace of the one I'd just drawn. And that proved a really important part of this body of work. Total accident, but I think with a lot of work, accidents happens, but I think it's more about being aware of the accident and taking advantage of the accident. My stuff tends to look like it's just done, but it's actually very manipulated. I take advantage of things. And so this idea of leaving something which was a memory of an earlier event, I found incredibly powerful, particularly with the photographic references of these. And also just on a visual level, I actually really like the abstraction of what had gone before, and it changed how I thought about the abstraction of these characters, and it actually made them visually, I think, more engaging. So there was a relationship that happened with the old imagery and then the newer images. They could start having a conversation between past and present, and I think that was a massive leap in this work. What I should also talk about is these hairy borders. And coming on the back of, it's where history of artwork starts coming in. I've done a lot of work about sexual fetish, about underwear fetishism, and about pubic hair. In the miscarriage work, on the long scroll, I gave birth to three hairy kids, and the idea was that this tiger character, which is me, actually gave birth to three hairy children, which is repellent. It was like a fur ball. So these ideas of these borders being of hair, it almost tries to capture that thing of being both a beautiful thing and precious, but also slightly repellent and sad, because it's gone. It's gone in the past, it's gone in that split second, and it's part of our being, but it's gone. I think what I started getting interested in here as well is that with that variety of type, the scale and difference of the type, where things are coming forward, things are dropping back. Some bits being very clear, some bits literally you're gone like that, some bits are more that. You know, and I like the way images push and pull people. You know, in terms of content, some of the things happening here are bits of jokes, bits of talking to one of my kids at school, and, you know, even things like on here where you're beginning to get things out of crackers, then really rubbish jokes in crackers at Christmas, you know. Why couldn't the skeleton go to the Christmas party? Because he had nobody to go with. Absolute rubbish. Brilliant. What do you call a boomerang that doesn't come back? A stick. It's that bad. It's kind of funny, you know. And it's, I love that whatever's going on, that still exists. We've got birthday greetings. I love what people write in cards, birthday cards or any kind of card really, because we often say the same thing. You know, happy birthday, hope you have a good day. Hope you get lots of nice presents, enjoy that special time. You know, it's great, it's so familiar, yet actually when you take it out of it, it becomes very special. The battle comics, which are obviously all from my youth, 7p 1976, you know, obviously the various years, but it's the language of the comics which I found interesting this time, and anything which I thought related to everyday life I would cut out. And it's amazing, just the, you know, obviously in this comic it's all related to war, but actually outside of this, once you remove them, they just become everyday language, and I was kind of interested in that. So these boxes, you know, every household I think's got them from my generation, and they're just wonderful time capsules, not in any order particularly, but just referencing people's journeys and lives, like my mom when she was a young mom. My mum as a gran and mother-in-law. My mum as a big sister and daughter. My mum chilling out on the beach. The mum I remember. And these titles which we give to all ourselves, really. You know, I'm a dad, I'm a brother, I'm a son, I'm a tutor, I'm a artist, I'm a uncle, you know, and a friend. They're all titles we carry in, and we almost have a different hat for each title almost. And it kind of interests me, you know, a changing title. COVID's had quite an impact actually on this project, in a good way, I think, even though in an annoying way. This work was to be exhibited in May 2020, and I was all ready to go, really. And obviously the pandemic hit and everything was cancelled. But actually what that's given me, I thought the project was finished, but actually what it did was allow me to push on and to push harder with it, I think. And I suppose what I'm really saying there, it's not about pushing harder at all. It's actually about time to look for new challenges within the work, for new opportunities, for further visual development and content development. And actually, I think it's a better body of work now due to COVID. Not because of the isolation, but just the time of the exhibition has given me further time to build on earlier successes and failures. I think working from home, as in teaching wise, is incredibly frustrating. But again, part of that frustration, part of the difficulty, has been part of the process. You know, being annoyed that I couldn't go out for a pint, being frustrated I couldn't go and watch me team with the kids play football. You know, all that stuff which you just take for granted has become part of the ongoing kaleidoscope of events in a way. So I think actually the pandemic has been a positive for me in relation to the artwork. That might be the only bit of it that's been positive, but I would say that has been significant. And I would say recently, in the latter stages of the work, I'm actually doing a piece which directly links to COVID and my dad having COVID and being in hospital with it, and the events which have come from that. So it's actually, I suppose, in this latest work, it's actually embedded very visibly in the project. At this stage, what I was trying to do was really abstract my own abstraction, and I was going for that pixelated where nothing literally goes together. So like the idea itself where things collide, I was now doing that with the soldiers. Hardly ever do I get two soldiers from the same kind of genre. I'm trying to literally create this kaleidoscopic effect where it's, I'm breaking down and breaking down these ideas and enjoying that struggle, that constant battle to not repeat. To go, oh, this is green, this one's blue, this is red, this is yellow, this is from the 15th century, this is from 1945. So all of that stuff, and also what was happening was I was obliterating my own writing, so writing became more gestural, even though it was all informed and observed and thought about, but I was actually breaking that down as well. So literally this is becoming a kaleidoscope, not just in terms of the visual, but actually in terms of the content. Everything is becoming pixelated and broken. Also, I think at this point, I'm starting to really think about destroying my own drawing, destroying my own words, destroying the things I've built up to this point in order to create this even more complex, more kaleidoscopic. Things are still in blocks here and are quite regimented to a certain degree. So at this point I'm thinking about, there's that great Malcolm McLaren quote about you've got to destroy in order to create, and I think at this point I'm really beginning to get momentum into that, destroying what I've created to create the next one. I show for two reasons. One is to actually look at the work collectively, properly, which gives me a platform for where I'm going next. But in terms of what I would like people to get from this work is, like with all my artwork, what I've always wanted is, I really want to make people think. You know, I want people to slow down, to be challenged, and to think about the content of the work. And with a bit of luck, find the artwork themselves visually really exciting. But I want to provoke thought. I want to challenge people within that thought. This subject matter, I think, is connected to every human being. You know, we all have conflicting emotional landscapes going on. And for me, it's a recognition of humanness and a recognition of self. And that can be often really uncomfortable. and difficult, because it's like someone holding the mirror up sometimes, and that can be, as we know in the morning, you know, when we look in the mirror, it can be quite shocking. So yeah, I think it's about provoking thought and challenging people's thoughts. And also within that as well, I would like for people to accept their humanness in a way that maybe, as I've got older, I've begun to accept the conflict, accept the difficulties within the landscape of happiness and joy. Yeah, that's it, probably. And obviously, I hope someone gives us about £3 billion. And that'll be quite handy as well, so I can buy me a yacht and live happily ever after in a conflicting, really lovely landscape.